Good morning, Your Honors. May it please the court, my name is Negwa Ibrahim, attorney for the petitioner, Brian Rosalio Guzman-Nunez. I will be addressing the court specifically as it relates to the CAT claims. Amicus counsel will be addressing as it relates to the jurisdictional issue. With respect to the CAT claim, we believe there are two main issues. The first issue is that the IJ and BIA did not analyze the evidence based on whether an individual in petitioner's circumstances would be subjected to torture. And what I specifically mean by that is petitioner in this case, at the age of 19, was the subject of an innocent victim of a drive-by shooting, and as a result was paralyzed from the waist down, restricted to a wheelchair for the rest of his life. Although he is restricted to a wheelchair, cannot walk, he still experiences chronic pain. He can still feel, so he has chronic pain throughout his body. Additionally, he has a bullet lodged in his back, which couldn't be removed because of medical complications that would arise. So that also creates additional medical complications for him in his life. The acts which the petitioner would be subjected to by the Belizean government, while the government argues those acts wouldn't amount to torture, they would amount to torture for the petitioner because of his medical condition.
Would they be affirmative acts or just medical neglect?
No, they would be affirmative acts. So when petitioner, after the shooting incident that happened to the petitioner, he grew up in a very rough neighborhood. He has been in the United States since he was 5 years old, grew up in a rough neighborhood in South Los Angeles. After this shooting happened, he ended up joining a gang for protection because of his additional vulnerability. So he was part of a gang. As a result, developed a criminal record.
What affirmative acts would be tantamount to torture?
So the affirmative acts, so because he had prior gang affiliations, a criminal record, as well as gang tattoos all over his body, visible gang tattoos, when he gets deported to Belize, he will be immediately interviewed by the Crime Intelligence Unit, as well as detained for a period of, at minimum, 24 to 72 hours.
Let's respond to what Judge Wynn asked. What affirmative acts will occur when he is sent to Belize that would amount to torture? Interview is certainly not one of them.
No, but he would be detained in a jail facility.
Detention itself is not one. So tell us how whatever you think they're going to do to him would amount to torture.
So while detention itself is not an act of torture, the fact that he is limited to a wheelchair, the jail facilities in Belize have no accommodations. So as a result, by detaining him, he would be forced to crawl on floors to use the bathrooms. He would not be provided his medication, which would cause him chronic pain. He would also not have access to a nurse that could change his catheters because he has catheters that have to be changed by a nurse on a daily basis. And as a result, he could suffer fatal infections.
What was the affirmative evidence in this record?
So the affirmative evidence...
Let me just finish my question.
Yes, sorry, Your Honor.
What was the affirmative evidence in this record that he would be subjected to that kind of treatment? I'm looking in the record for something that says that intentional suffering will be inflicted upon him because of his disability, and all I can find is a statement that they really don't have facilities.
Well, Your Honor, intentional infliction would be, he would be subjected to this intentional infliction of pain and suffering, of physical pain and suffering, not because of his disability, but because of the fact that he's a deportee from the United States with prior gang affiliations.
No, but I'm asking again, because the records, the witness that you presented said it's likely, he never claimed it was likely the police would torture him. He only said it was likely the police would interrogate him and detain him. With respect to jail facilities, I'm looking, trying to find in the record where there's something that supports the claims that you're making.
So, again, within the record, I believe it's on page 602 to 613. The expert does talk about the lack of accommodations in these facilities, but the fact that he would specifically...
But she was also pretty vague, wasn't she? I mean, she said it used to be not that good, and I don't really know if they've improved it.
So she did say specifically the detention jail that he would be detained in upon arrival, that specific facility would not have medical accommodations, and that while they are trying to catch up in Belize in terms of accommodating those with disabilities,
right, but
they are far behind.
Poor conditions that is going to be worse for him due to his physical condition. But is that tantamount to a deliberate intent to inflict harm?
Well, again, what is argued by petitioner is not only that he would be subjected to detention, but that he would also be required, because of the fact of his criminal record, gang tattoos, prior gang affiliation, which he has since is no longer affiliated with, that he would be required, according to the Summary Jurisdiction Act, Belizean law, to report to the police commission.
Right. Again, we're really looking for those affirmative acts that would be tantamount to torture. So detention, reporting because of his perceived status, some harassment. None of those things seem to be tantamount to torture.
But again, looking when it comes to his particular circumstance, which is that he has this disability and that Belize does not accommodate those with his disability, him having to report regularly with the police commission. So upon arrival to Belize, he will be required for 6 months, possibly longer, to report to the police commission. That means he has to get himself to the police station and report.
So let's focus on that.
Yeah.
Let's assume that's all that he was required to do was report to the police commission, and it was very difficult to get there. That's not torture, is it?
Well, it does, under the
definition in our cases and the statute, is that torture?
Well, Your Honor, I would argue that it does become torture when, if he doesn't report, he's detained in a facility that then doesn't accommodate his.
So your real argument is about the facility, is it not? It's not the requirement to report. Your real argument is that if he is detained, the facility will lack accommodations.
Yes, and that in his particular circumstance, these acts would amount to severe physical pain and suffering.
But the only act that would amount to severe physical pain and suffering, as I understand your argument, is his detention in a facility that doesn't have appropriate accommodations. If he were detained in Springfield, Missouri, at the U.S. hospital, you would not have a torture argument, would you?
Well, Your Honor, in
no?
Sorry.
Yeah, that answers the question I asked. Well, if he were detained in Springfield, Missouri, at the United States hospital that deals with prisoners, you would not have a torture claim, would you?
Well, we would if they were targeting him specifically, not because of any acts that he actually committed, but just because of his background that has nothing to do with any actual acts that he committed in terms of.
But targeting because of your background is not torture. Targeting, it may be persecution, it may be a withholding claim, but when you have a CAT claim, you must show that the government intentionally, or somebody else with the acquiescence of the government, inflicts torture on someone.
So
the question we keep asking, and I know you want to say something else, but please listen to the question we keep asking, is what's the specific act of torture that you think will be inflicted on your client? And I think your answer is, he may be detained in a facility that doesn't have the kind of accommodations that he would need. Is that a fair statement?
Yes, and in addition to that, Your Honor, the other thing the petitioner raises is that he would also be subjected to the surveillance and monitoring of the gang suppression unit. The gang suppression.
So is that torture?
Yes.
Under any case? What case says that surveillance is torture?
Well, Your Honor, the gang suppression unit doesn't just surveillance and monitor. That the expert witness testified to the fact that the gang suppression unit is otherwise known as a paramilitary unit, as a death squad.
But there's no evidence here that it's more likely than not that he's going to be killed by the paramilitary unit.
The expert did testify that it's more likely than not that he would have interactions with the gang suppression unit because of his Afro-Belizean background, as well as because of his gang tattoos, so there is perceived gang affiliation, that he would be subject to excessive use of force by the gang suppression unit.
But not more likely than not for the level of proof that you would need for a CAT claim, right?
Well, the expert witness did testify repeatedly that more likely than not, she believes this would happen to him.
But what would happen was included surveillance or maybe an interview or a lot of things that wouldn't count as torture.
Again, looking at it in its whole, and I want to reserve some time for rebuttal, and I don't believe that I'll be able to, but I only have 12 seconds left.
Go ahead and answer the question.
Okay. So again, looking at the whole picture, what the expert said is more likely than not, he will be detained upon arrival because of his background. More likely than not, he could be detained for a prolonged period of time. Now, again, it's a minimum of...
The language in Cole v. Holder about a torturer must have the specific intent to inflict severe harm. I think that's what we're all asking you about, that these things that might happen to him might, in fact... cause him to suffer, but the intent to inflict severe harm seems to be the missing link for all of these things.
But I would argue that the intent to inflict severe harm is detaining him for possibly prolonged periods of time because of the fact that he's a deportee with his prior gang affiliations. That
I think we've got the argument, and I know that you wanted to save time for Ms. Murchev. Okay. Am I pronouncing that correctly, Murchev?
Yes. Thank you,
to address the jurisdictional issue.
Okay. Thank you, Your Honor.
Good morning, Your Honors, and may it please the Court. Brianna Murchev on behalf of AMICI. I appreciate the Court's invitation to argue here today. My time is brief, so I want to jump right into what I see as the two fallacies at the heart of the government's jurisdictional arguments. One is that a regulation cannot be jurisdictional because an agency cannot define its own jurisdiction. And two, that even if it can be, this one was not intended to be. Let me start with the first one, which is that this regulation cannot be jurisdictional because an agency can't define its own jurisdiction. My reading is that that's cut off by Kerengeti itself, which holds that the regulatory definition governs the immigration court's jurisdiction.
Well, it's not cut off by Kerengeti. Kerengeti says the regulation at issue in that case is not jurisdictional. The statute is not jurisdictional because it has no language about jurisdiction. And then it says this reg has language about jurisdiction. How it defines, what I'm interested in, and I'm not sure either side is addressed in this case, is let's assume, because the reg speaks of jurisdiction, it speaks of jurisdiction, it's jurisdictional. Is it subject matter jurisdictional or personal jurisdictional? In other words, the jurisdiction of the district court over me vests when I'm served with a summons. Right. But if I don't show, if I show up and don't complain about the summons, then the court has personal jurisdiction over me. It's a waiver. It's not a subject matter jurisdictional issue. It doesn't deprive the court of the ability to act, even if I've been served with an inappropriate summons. So when this reg speaks of vesting jurisdiction, is it speaking of subject matter jurisdiction or personal jurisdiction?
I believe it is talking about subject matter jurisdiction.
And what do you base that argument on?
So to start, that's what the government argued in Kerengeti.
I know, but the government's wrong wrong a lot of the time. I'm not bound by their losing arguments.
But I also think the entire regulatory scheme is not simply about personal jurisdiction, but shifting the adjudicatory authority from one agency to the other. Right?
Why is that? This is very much akin in my mind, this notice to appear, the charges, to the summons and complaint in a civil case. We want you to show up and answer to something. Here's what it is. And in this case, I think nobody disagrees that the defendant showed up and defended at the appropriate place and time without complaining about the form of the notice. Under those circumstances, why should we say that the court lacked any jurisdiction to proceed?
I think, again, not only did the regulation use jurisdiction vests, strong jurisdictional language, but the regulatory scheme shifts the authority, right? Until that moment, it's not a question of merely personal jurisdiction. It's a matter that court has no power.
Well, you say that, but that's the conclusion. I'm trying to figure out what the supporting argument for it is. It says jurisdiction, and the Supreme Court's told us be careful about that term. It's a wastebasket term.
True.
And we do know from Civil Procedure 101 that there are two types of jurisdiction, subject matter and personal. And so I'm trying to figure out, and I don't think I know the answer, why I should interpret this as subject matter as opposed to personal. So what is there in the case law, in the history of this or whatever, that leads me to one choice rather than the other?
Right. So matter of GNC also uses the same language about it shifting the authority, right, the authority of the court to adjudicate the case. So that's certainly an example. But again, I go back to simply that's what happens under the regulations. Under 239, until the notice to appear is filed, the agency can do whatever it wants. It can put the case into reinstatement proceedings. It can look at admin removals or expedited removals. As soon as it does that, then the authority is with the immigration court. And that's a matter of subject matter jurisdiction and not merely personal jurisdiction.
So is it possible to separate out the sentences of 1003.14a? So the first sentence, it says jurisdiction vests and proceedings before an immigration judge commence when a charging document is filed with the immigration court by the service. That is the jurisdictional sentence. And the next one that talks about what a charging document must include is more of a claims processing or some other kind of rule?
I think that this is where Pereira is helpful, because Pereira says when we talk about charging documents, we're not just simply talking about a document that says at the top, notice to appear. There has to be some content. And here, I think the content is given by the second sentence that says it must, at a very minimum, tell the non-citizen what court it is that he's expected to show up in, what court it is that has power over his case.
But that right? doesn't mean that it's jurisdictional. The second sentence isn't cast in jurisdictional terms, so why can't it be just merely a claim processing issue?
Because, again, not only does it use the term jurisdiction.
Not the second sentence.
Not the second sentence having to do with the certificate of service. It's only the first sentence that speaks in jurisdictional terms.
That's true. But, again, under Pereira, it's not simply enough that the documents say notice to appear, right?
That well, to trigger to the time running, but that doesn't really tell us about
it
jurisdiction.
It also rejected the argument that you can simply say because a document has a title on it, it suffices to give notice.
But I think as we've noticed several times in our cases, and the Supreme Court seems to be suggesting, Pereira is quite a different thing. We have a fiction there that getting a notice serves some function of stopping the clock. Right. And under those circumstances, the court says, look, if you're going to pretend that somebody knows that the clock is stopped by when you get one of these notices, the notice ought to conform to the regs. But that's it. There's nothing in Pereira about jurisdiction. It's just about the effect of the notice.
That's true. But again, I would push back, right? If the document doesn't have, at the bare minimum, information about what immigration court has jurisdiction over the case, then there's a very real limitation on what the non-citizen can do, right?
This is a technical argument, is it not? I mean, in the sense that nobody's alleging that Mr. Nunez was in any way prejudiced in this case by not getting the information that was missing.
True, though, because it's jurisdictionally doesn't have to show.
I understand. No, that's right. Why it's a technical argument.
But I want to push back against it being technical, right? So next week, this court en banc is going to hear the case of Lopez v. Barr. And in the briefs in that case, one of the arguments that they've indicated is that there's sometimes a year to 2 year lag between the time of a notice to appear and the notice of hearing. During that case, there are very real limitations on what the non-citizen can do if they don't know what court has jurisdiction over the case. They can't file a change of address or a change of venue. They can't file a motion to terminate if, for example, they've married a U.S. citizen in the interim or they vacated their criminal convictions. The non-citizen's attorney doesn't know where to file their form to say that they're attorney. And if for some reason they need to get that case on calendar sooner, there's no way for that person to find out what court has jurisdiction, has
authority over their
case.
But unlike this case where Mr. Nunez knew.
Well, in this case, the notice to appear and the notice of hearing were rather quick. Again, in that briefing, they point to examples of cases where there's a lag of 1 or 2 years.
Speaking of Lorenzo Lopez, there's another panel, Aguilar-Furman, that may also, I don't know if you're aware of that, may have an impact on resolution of this case. So it seems to make sense for this panel to hold this case in abeyance pending resolution of those.
Well, I'm sorry, I'm not familiar with which aspect of this case that one is intended.
They're
to
considering touch. this very regulation.
The same regulations.
Both 14 and 15.
I'm not sure we know that, but maybe 15.
But at least they're both
15.
They're both at issue in the briefs in that case. And okay. So one thing you might want to do is
I would be happy to
think about seeking to file your amicus brief in that case.
That's Aguilar Furman versus Barr, 18-70855. It was submitted February 13th.
Okay.
And we apologize that we're only notifying you of that today. We kind of are just figuring it out ourselves.
This is obviously a very hot issue right now, and there's a lot of people raising.
So I had one other question for this. I know the circuits are split in their description of this provision. Is there any court of appeals case that invalidates proceedings for failure to comply with what I would call 14?
There are not that I'm aware of. But what I would say,
it comes up, and the reason you're most interested, of course, is it comes up in criminal cases.
Yes.
Is there any district court case that throws out?
There are a number of district court cases.
And they're split on this.
The district courts in this court, and indeed here in Los Angeles, there's a split among the district courts as well.
And there's a split among the district courts, too, about whether this is a subject matter jurisdictional thing or a personal jurisdictional thing.
I believe there's one court that's talked about personal jurisdiction, but most of them have talked about subject matter versus claim processing.
So I understand why, as a public defender, it seems like having a bunch of orders lose jurisdiction is helpful. But there are also people who get relief. And I'm just wondering, like, what the effect of the rule you're asking for would be on people who are seeking asylum, who've gotten asylum. What would happen if we agreed with you?
So obviously, this case is not a final order. Once there is a final order, there is a constellation of doctrines that kick into place that keep an order.
But if the order comes from a court that had no jurisdiction, what happens?
So, and obviously this would have to be litigated in other cases, but certainly the argument the government is making in certain criminal cases is that you cannot collaterally, once there's a final order, you cannot collaterally challenge jurisdiction under Contract v. Ryan. Now, again, far be it from me to concede that that's necessarily true, but there's retroactivity doctrines, there's limitations on the ability to collaterally challenge
an
order.
Take it outside the criminal context. Take it back
to
the immigration context. I got asylum. I went to a court and got asylum.
Yes, and so
it seems to me the upshot of your argument is I didn't get asylum because the court that granted it to me had no subject matter jurisdiction to do so.
Sure. So I guess I would point the court to Zhao v. Barr, which is, again, the case the government is citing in a lot of criminal cases to say that this cannot be collaterally challenged once the order is final, even if it's jurisdictional.
Well, when does the order become final?
Once it's gone through administrative review and through the...
But our case law says that if the IJ had no jurisdiction, then we lack jurisdiction to review. So I don't even know how we'd go through the steps of an asylum case if your argument is correct.
So, I mean, if our argument is correct and the IJ didn't have jurisdiction, then I do think it would have to... So, for example, in this case, had he been granted CAT, I don't think we would be here, but...
Indeed, they would have no jurisdiction under your argument to grant him cat relief.
It's far less likely that this court is going to be presented with non-final grants of relief simply because more often it's the non-citizen appealing than the government.
But if we thought, I mean, so they're all different postures, right? Sometimes people get asylum. Maybe then there's no jurisdiction to give them asylum. People who wanted asylum who were denied and want to appeal to us, like, we might agree, but now we're going to lack jurisdiction to say.
So, and the other thing I would say is that this would not mean that they could not be repapered, brought back in on another NTA, and that there might not be doctrines such as...
But you're the person who was talking about this terrible delay. So in this case, let's assume we agree that Mr. Nunez ought to get cat relief. What you're telling us is that we have no jurisdiction to tell the IJ to give him cat relief.
My position would be that he would have to be repapered in this case with a new NTA.
Or that, to put it differently, even if we think the IJ should have granted cat relief, we can't grant the petition for review.
Your Honor, as amicus, I'm in a difficult position because obviously...
No, I understand.
But that's the natural consequence of your position, really. Yes, but I believe, again, this is talking only about non-final orders, and I believe he would have to be repapered.
But what about people who make affirmative asylum claims? Like, some people make them defensively because they're in deportation proceedings, but some people start their case themselves, so then what?
Well, but that's...
I guess then they don't
case.
Have an NTA.
NTA.
I guess, okay.
They would only be NTA'd if they lose their affirmative claim, is my understanding.
I see. That makes sense.
Our questioning has taken you well over time.
I apologize.
But we thank you for coming
it.
In on the case
thank
as well.
You.
Thank you.
And thank you for the excellent brief.
May it please the court. My name is Jennifer Singer, and I represent the United States Attorney General, the respondent in this matter. To start, the court should hold that the regulations at issue here do not implicate subject matter jurisdiction, but are rather claims processing rules. Amicus, in their brief, argues that the court is compelled to find otherwise because of its decision in Karangithi. But it is our position that Karangithi does not control here.
It doesn't control in the sort of strictest sense because it doesn't hold anything, but it sure seems to suppose that this is a jurisdictional rule because it says the statute's not jurisdictional. Jurisdiction is defined by the regs. If that, the reasoning of Karangithi, right or wrong, which we're about, you know, seems to suggest that it's a jurisdictional rule.
It does seem to suggest on its face, but a deeper dive into that is not the case. It's notable that
it says pretty clearly jurisdiction vests in the immigration court when a charging document such as a notice to appear is filed, citing to 14.14, right? So are you saying that it's merely dicta?
It is merely dicta. The court is parroting the language of the regulation, and it's important that within all of Karangithi, the court doesn't use the word subject matter jurisdiction. And it also is
But notable. Isn't that the clear implication that it was talking about subject matter jurisdiction?
I don't think so, and I don't think it had the opportunity to even address the effect of or to address whether the regulation was a claims processing rule or a subject matter jurisdiction rule. In Karangithi, the court found that the NTA was sufficient under the regulation, so it didn't have the opportunity to address the issue of the legal effect of a deficient NTA.
No, we all understand that, but it's essential reasoning seemed to be the reg defines jurisdiction. You're attacking the statute, therefore, you're out of luck. But the underlying assumption, and indeed the government's briefing in that case, said, you know, this would be a different case if we were dealing with the reg. That's jurisdictional. We're not dealing with the reg. We're dealing with the statute. So the question in my mind is whether it was an implicit assumption or reasoned dictum or whatever we call stuff that's not the strict holding of the case.
I mean, I think it's dicta, and I think it's notable that the court did not use the word subject matter jurisdiction, and I think it left open the possibility of the effect of the regulation's wording, whether the regulation did intend for it to be subject matter jurisdiction or a claims processing rule.
But the government's brief argued that it was jurisdiction. No one was talking about claims processing. So, and our court said jurisdiction. So, I mean, maybe you can say it's not reasoned dicta, but even if it's dicta, we would have to say it's not reasoned dicta to not be bound by it, wouldn't we?
I think so, and I think it is dicta. It's not controlling, and I think...
And you think it's not even reasoned?
I think there were perhaps assumptions made, and I think it goes to what the Supreme Court has cautioned against, that the use of the word jurisdiction is often used pretty loosely, and I think maybe the regulation is imprecise and loose in its use of the word jurisdiction. I think the government was probably imprecise and loose in its use of the word jurisdiction, and maybe the court was as well. Since Karangithi, I think the law has evolved and the government's position has evolved, and to the effect of that the rule, that the regulation does not implicate subject matter jurisdiction, but a claims processing rule.
So say we could get to the point where we agree with you that we're not bound by Karangithi. Maybe it's not reasoned dicta. Then what do we do about our deference, given that the government has changed its position, given that it doesn't really seem to know what jurisdiction means? How can we say that we need to defer to you on this issue?
I don't think the court, and we're not asking the court to, I don't think it has to defer to the board's decision or defer to the government's interpretation of the rule. The court can simply look at the statutory scheme, look at the regulation, the purpose, and its history, and come to its own conclusion that the regulations were meant to set forth a claims processing rule.
You keep using the term claims processing rule, and I guess, like jurisdiction, it's a wastebasket term. I'm not sure I quite understand it. Let's assume this is akin to a summons and complaint in a civil case, which seems to me a pretty good analogy. Is the requirement that a summons and complaint be served on someone in a civil case a claims processing rule, or does it go to the jurisdiction of the court to proceed?
It is my understanding that cases have held that deficiencies in service of a complaint do not deprive the court of subject matter jurisdiction.
Of subject matter jurisdiction, but it doesn't make it a claims processing rule. It makes it a personal jurisdictional rule.
I mean, honestly, I have not really thought about the nuances of personal jurisdiction versus a claims processing rule.
So let me change the facts for you a little bit. Let's assume you serve one of these deficient notices on Mr. Nunez, and he doesn't show up. Could the court default him and proceed in absentia?
So
immigration court? I think he'd have a great argument that you never obtained personal jurisdiction over me because you never served me with the appropriate NTA.
I mean, yes, and in that circumstance, he could go to the court and ask for rescission of the, if he were ordered
not
to
remain
in absentia.
Not only rescission, I think he'd be entitled to treat it just as in civil cases when a court doesn't have personal jurisdiction over you, he'd be entitled to treat the court's order as null and void.
If that were to happen, if he was ordered removed in absentia, that would be his recourse. But for issues, let's say he did appear, and for the claims processing aspect of it, and he was somehow prejudiced or something happened where he couldn't file an address form in time or a motion to change venue in time, then the recourse wouldn't be, I mean, there wouldn't be an in absentia order, but the recourse here would be, hey, immigration judge, these regulations were not filed. I was somehow prejudiced because these things didn't happen, and that would be remedied then.
Does he have to show prejudice? Because that was my next question. I had default. Now I've got the guy showing up. He shows up. He's been served with a deficient notice. And he says, Mr. Immigration Judge or Ms. Immigration Judge, you don't have jurisdiction over me. Jurisdiction didn't vest because I wasn't served with the appropriate notice. What should the judge do under those circumstances?
Under those circumstances,
The reg hasn't been followed.
I think the case law says that if the government doesn't, or the agency does not comply with the regulation, then the person would have to show that he was prejudiced by the government's failure to follow the regulation.
So that even though you've served him with an inappropriate summons or notice to appear, and he raises that to the immigration judge, he must also show prejudice from you not following your own regulations?
Based upon the case law, yes, he would have
to
show prejudice.
What case do you cite for that?
I don't know off the top of my head, but it is in the supplemental brief that we filed. But prejudice is a requirement for
prejudice. I understand why prejudice may be a requirement if you show up and don't raise it. And that's what I think the cases you cited stand for the proposition of. I'm not sure any case you've cited stands for the proposition that if you show up and attack the sufficiency of the notice, you must also say, and I've been prejudiced by the insufficiency of the notice. If there is such a case, I'm not aware of it.
I could look into that further, but I think the cases we cite do stand for the proposition that for a regulatory violation, the alien has to show prejudice. And it's just hard-pressed to find instances.
Even if he brings the regulatory violation to the attention of the administrative officer and the administrative officer refuses to correct it?
I mean, I don't know what would happen at the time of the administrative officer, but by the time you get into the immigration proceedings, you would raise it before the immigration judge, and that would be your opportunity to challenge the violation.
And if the immigration judge says, tough luck, I don't care what the notice looks like, we would not find that to be error later in the absence of him showing prejudice.
I mean, that would something that would have to go before the board and then potentially up to this court to decide whether.
You've answered it procedurally. I'm asking the substantive question. Would it be error or not?
I'm sorry, repeat the question.
He shows up. He's been served with a facially insufficient notice. He says to the immigration judge, I attack this notice. The judge says, tough luck, I don't care. The Board of Immigration Appeals says, tough luck, I don't care. He petitions for review to us. Does he get relief?
Yes, because the court could review it because it's a claims processing issue. It's not like a subject matter jurisdictional issue.
So your answer to my question then is that the immigration judge at the beginning of the case, when he sees a deficient notice, should say, government, it's an insufficient notice. You must serve him with a new one if you want jurisdiction to vest in this court.
I think that's assuming, though, that the service or the filing of the notice appear implicates subject matter jurisdiction. It doesn't.
No, I'm assuming it implicates personal jurisdiction. This happens in district courts all the time. People come to the district judge and say, I wasn't served properly with the summons and complaint, or the summons and complaint is deficient in some way. And the district judge says, yes, you're right. I cannot exercise personal jurisdiction in this case until appropriate service is made. Now, I'm not sure why it hurts your argument here. I'm just trying to figure out if it is a claims processing rule and you don't follow it, what happens when somebody calls you on it?
Then my answer to that is when the alien brings it up to the attention of the immigration judge saying, hey, this is defective, then the alien would also have to show that this impacted me negatively and therefore.
So I think I found the part of your brief where you make this prejudice argument. I think it's page 16 of your supplemental brief, and I think the only case you cite is Karangisi. So I don't think that's going to really help us with this problem. And so do you have any other case that tells us that what you're saying about not being able to assert a deficiency, especially if the regulation is interpreted as jurisdictional, which I know you're resisting, but that you'd also have to show prejudice?
I thought we said it's additional case. I don't recall citing Karangisi, but I can go back and I can respond to the court's question in a later filing.
Here's the difficulty, and this is probably helpful to your position. I'm viewing this as a personal jurisdictional rule, at least for purposes of my question. You keep resisting that. You keep saying, oh, no, you got to show prejudice, too. And if you got to show prejudice, too, then it seems to me we can't really treat it as a personal jurisdictional rule, because you don't have to show prejudice when the court doesn't have personal jurisdiction. You just have to raise it.
I think the reason for the government's argument on this front is that since Karangisi, the law has developed, and the position since Karangisi has been that it's the regulatory scheme in this section is a claims processing rule.
So what do you mean by the law has developed? Do you mean that now the BIA has come out with a decision that we should give our deference to? Because I thought before you said you weren't relying on our deference.
No, we're not. I think the court can come to the claims processing conclusion without relying on the board's decision or deferring to the board's decision anyway.
So what do you mean by that law developing?
The circuit courts have come out with decisions on the subject, finding that the regulation is not doesn't implicate subject matter jurisdiction. We've had more conferred with criminal AUSAs, the OSG's office, and the board has also issued a decision on this matter, and it's consistent with our view that the regulation is a claims processing rule and not a subject matter jurisdiction rule.
Well, some of the other circuit courts don't have Karangisi in place, and we do. So assuming that Karangisi was talking about subject matter jurisdiction when it cites to point 14, does that necessarily extend to the second sentence of that regulation that addresses a certificate of service?
So two answers to that. First, it's the government's position that the entire regulation is claims processing. If the court were to find that Karangisi does control and that the first sentence is jurisdictional, I don't think that jurisdictional aspect or does implicate subject matter jurisdiction. I don't think that goes to the second sentence. And just the history of the regulation, it just cannot be that a deficiency in a certificate of service would render an immigration judge without subject matter jurisdiction over a case. I don't think Congress intended that. I don't think the regulation intends that.
Did Congress intend for the Attorney General to be able to define his own jurisdiction?
No, Congress did not.
So if he didn't, and this reg doesn't define jurisdiction, where do we find the extent of jurisdiction? In the statute?
In the statute. Congress...
But then Karangisi was wrong, because Karangisi said the statute is not jurisdictional.
I don't think Karangisi fully addressed the issue present here. It didn't address who's able to define jurisdiction. It didn't address congressional authorities or...
Well, but doesn't it at least, whatever it stands for, doesn't it reject the argument that the regulations don't define jurisdiction? It says
yes.
It says the statute doesn't define jurisdiction, the regulations do. What kind of jurisdiction they define and whether it's a claims processing rule put aside. But in your argument that the regulations can't define jurisdiction...
That's correct.
...expressly rejected by Karangisi?
Again, it depends on when the meaning of the word jurisdiction.
Well, back to the question of where would we look for the definition of jurisdiction if it's not the regulations?
8 U.S.C. 1229A, the Congress gave the immigration courts broad authority over removal proceedings. And that's not limited in any way, particularly not by any rule governing what's the contents of an NTA. And there's no separate statute saying that the Attorney General is able to craft regulations that do have jurisdictional significance. So it's just that one statutory 1229A broad grant of authority that gives the subject matter jurisdiction to immigration judges over removal proceedings.
With no information about how a proceeding would start or anything about its parameters, that's just all we would have.
Yes, it gave the agency the regulatory ability to define how cases proceed before it, and those are the regulations at issue here, the rules of procedure.
All right. Thank you very much, counsel, both sides, for your argument. And we thank the Public Defender's Office for stepping in as well. The matter is submitted.